subscribe Tag TV YouTube channel and press the notification button.
People have to live in unity.
We are still in transition.
Civil society has been decimated.
Of course, we rely on media.
And I think the government has not done enough.
The international community has failed to respond.
No place in the world is perfect.
Hello viewers, I'm your host Uzma Jafri with another episode of South Asia Focus. Let's begin the show with 20th SCO Summit that was held virtually owing to the pandemic. Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi, in a veiled reference to Pakistan and China, urged countries to refrain from hurting or having an intention of doing something against the sovereignty of the country. The duo of Islamabad and China has consistently been trying to infiltrate into Indian territory to gain what observers call strategic advantages.
India believes it is important to enhance connectivity by respecting one another's sovereignty and territorial integrity. Indian Prime Minister Narendra Modi said in the 20th SCO summit, virtually hosted by Russia. It was the first meeting between Modi and Chinese Premier Xi Jinping since the army of the two sides clashed in a primitive fight, resulting in the death of 20 Indian soldiers and several Chinese. China, which has been criticized time and again by countries around the world for its expansionist strategies, was indirectly condemned by Modi for its role along India's northernmost territory, Ladakh. He urged countries to respect others' territorial integrity and sovereignty.
भारत का मानना है कि कनेक्टिविटी को और अधिक गहरा करने के लिए यह आवश्यक है कि एक दूसरे की संप्रभुता और टेरिटोरियल इंटीग्रिटी के सम्मान के मूल सिद्धांतों के साथ आगे बढ़ा जाए। यह दुर्भाग्यपूर्ण है कि एससीओ एजेंडा में बार बार अनावश्यक रूप से द्विपक्षीय मुद्दों को लाने के प्रयास हो रहे हैं, जो एससीओ चार्टर और संघाई स्पिरिट का उल्लंघन करते हैं।
India has been fighting a two-pronged undeclared war with China and Pakistan as both have intensified their infiltration activities along the borders. The assertive Indian forces, which has given its rivals a bloody in past, has not conceded an inch to the expansionists. The other leaders too urged for an increased cooperation amongst themselves, especially at a time when the world was suffering due to pandemic. While from outgoing US President Donald Trump to Australian Cabinet, everybody has criticized China for its role in the spread of the pandemic. Pakistani Prime Minister Imran heaped praise on Beijing.
Pakistan also deeply appreciates China's effective handling of the virus and also the material and technical assistance extended by China to others, including Pakistan. China and Pakistan also are collaborating in vaccine development, with phase 3 trials successfully underway.
Critics say there could be two reasons behind his choice of words. Either the copy editors of his script were sitting in Beijing, or Islamabad is about to ask for more money from China. Many of them also say that Pakistan has become a satellite state of China and acts as per the instructions of its master. Both countries have become infamous for jointly harassing millions of innocents in Pakistan. A large number of people in Gilgit-Baltistan, Balochistan and Sindh have been displaced owing to duo's rapacious plundering of the region. Activists and people in these regions say that international organizations such as SCO must step up to help them. But so far, no tangible progress has been made.
Moving on. A large number of activists in Pakistan's Sindh province held demonstration against Pakistan government. They shouted slogans of Sindhu Desh, a separate homeland they have been demanding for decades. Sindhis accuse Islamabad of plundering their region through several tactics, including the China-Pakistan economic corridor. They also accuse the military establishment of carrying out severe human rights violations for resisting their nefarious designs.
Sindhi activists and commoners took to streets against what they call as illegal occupation of their land by Pakistan. Held under the banner of Sindhu Desh Freedom Movement, the demonstration was aimed at demanding freedom from the clutches of Pakistan. The floats demonstrator carried read, "Sindhu Desh is our vision, mission, destiny and motherland." People also held pictures of Sindhi political activists and leaders who have been abducted or killed for their Sindhi nationalism. Sindhi leaders say that Pakistan has plundered their region of its resources and has been filling the coffers of Islamabad to serve Punjabis.
हम दुनिया को ये बताना चाहते हैं कि पाकिस्तान मुसलसल पूरी दुनिया को दुनिया के महज़ब ममालिक को गुमराह कर रहा है कि सीपेक इकोनॉमिकल कॉरिडोर है चाइना पाकिस्तान इकोनॉमिकल कॉरिडोर जो हम समझते हैं कि बुनियादी तौर पर सीपेक जो है वो चाइनीज पाकिस्तान मिलिट्री कॉरिडोर है और ये चाइना को ग्वादर और सिंध और बलूचिस्तान के जो साहली इलाके हैं हमारे जो समंदर हैं वो चाइना के हवाले किए गए हैं चाइना की नेवी को पाकिस्तान साजिश के तहत वहां पर मुनज़्ज़म कर रहा है ऑर्गेनाइज कर रहा है
While Pakistan's constitution recognizes Sindh as its province activists say that the region has for decades been subjected to state sponsored atrocities Home to majority of Hindus, Christians, Ahmadis and other minorities, Sindh is discriminated against with impunity. While the Sindhu Desh movement started as early as 1950s, it was the liberation of Bangladesh in 1971 that prompted Sindhis to demand a separate homeland. Unique non-Punjabi ethnicity and culture justifies their demand. However, Pakistan unleashed a brutal crackdown on those who dared to raise their voice. Arbitrary arrests, abductions and killings have become a norm now. As per a 2019 report, the Commission of Inquiry on Enforced Disappearances had 2,178 unresolved cases. The UN Working Group on Enforced or Involuntary Disappearance has more than 700 cases pending from Pakistan.
सीपेक की वजह से न सिर्फ हमारी रीजन के अंदर जो स्टेबिलिटी है वो मुतासर होगी बल्कि सिंध और बलूचिस्तान का जो कौमी वजूद है वो भी पाकिस्तान और चाइना के इस साजिश की वजह से सख्त खतरे में आ चुका है इसलिए हम दुनिया को ये बताना चाहते हैं कि पाकिस्तान में सीपेक की वजह से कोई तरक्की नहीं होगी बल्कि सिंध और बलोच कौम का जो है वो कत्लेआम किया जाएगा नंबर तीन के हमारे समंदरों के जो जज़ायर हैं वो पाकिस्तान ने चाइना को बेचे हुए हैं क्योंकि पाकिस्तान मुआशी तौर पर इकोनॉमिकली पाकिस्तान मुकम्मल तौर पर एक नाकाम रियासत साबित हुआ है सियासी और मुआशी हवाले से इसलिए वो सिंध को बेच रहा है
It is this region which reports cases of hate crime, anti-minority crime, forced conversions and marriages on almost everyday basis. Sindh is one of those possessions of Pakistan which it has used to accomplish its own materialistic agendas. The people on the other side have been accorded a second-class citizen treatment.
Moving on. While rage and terror have been two keywords of Afghan history in nearly two decades, it is the common man, the common Afghan, who has borne the brunt of a protracted conflict between the Taliban and the NATO-backed Afghan forces. While tens of thousands of innocents have lost their lives in the war, millions of others have been forced to flee. But the real troubles began there. Those who have left their homes are now pleading the United Nations to look into their deteriorating standards of living. They say they don't have jobs, food security, or for that matter, even hope of a better future.
A large number of refugees living in India held a demonstration in capital New Delhi and urged the United Nations to take immediate cognizance of their declining standards of living. While they have nothing against the host countries, for they have allowed their prolonged stays, it is the rapidly expanding unemployment and their diminishing capacity to sustain that has become the major cause of concern. They say that the United Nations Refugee Agency, UNHCR, hasn't done enough socially or economically, and they stand vulnerable at the cusp of getting perished. They demanded social protection packages and work permits from the UN.
Every day, we refugees face different challenges and problems. So we extremely request the United Nations, the international unity, to please pay attention on our problems. Because, you know, every day our refugees receive rejection letters. And the UNHCR realized that their documents were not acceptable after 4 or 5 years. So is that fair? It's my question from United Nations. So how should we live? Do we have the right to know about our future?
Hundreds of thousands of Afghan refugees have taken shelter across the globe owing to a continued conflict between the Taliban and the Afghan forces. A number of them came to India. New Delhi, despite a non-signatory to UN Refugee Convention 1951, has given refuge to a number of them. As of today, there are around 11,000 registered Afghan refugees in India. Many more have managed to live without refugee status. Pakistan, Afghanistan's immediate neighbor, has around 1.4 million registered Afghan refugees, but it has been mass deporting them back to their home. With no safe place for these refugees to return to, the situation has only worsened.
Afghanistan is very bad situation. We cannot say just economic situation. We have a very good country, we have a good university. I was in Kabul University, but in last 10 years, there is no facility for the Afghan people, but also there is a big war between Taliban and Afghan government.
The intra-Afghan peace talks that promised to restore peace in the region have yielded nothing concrete as of now. The solution doesn't seem to be appearing even in coming months. Taliban has in fact intensified its offensive. A UN report confirmed around 6,000 deaths in this year alone. While a growing Islamic terrorism has toughened the course of even innocent Afghans in getting refuge in different countries, even thinking of returning to the war-torn country, they say, sent chills down their spine. And while countries like India have lent a helping hand in the crisis, the tumultuous present and an uncertain future have made them more anxious and insecure.
Moving on. Leaders in the illegally occupied Gilgit-Baltistan have accused Islamabad of rigging polls before the actual election in the region. They say that the entire political machinery, including Prime Minister Imran Khan himself, has been working overtime to bring his own party into power. Pakistan earlier announced that the region will be given the status of a provincial province in the region, which the experts described as an exercise to polarize the polls.
As assembly election draws closer in the illegally occupied Gilgit-Baltistan, Islamabad has stepped up its nefarious designs to rig the polls. Islamabad administration, led by Pakistan Prime Minister Imran Khan, himself is doing all it can to manage the polls. The former chief minister of illegally occupied Gilgit-Baltistan, Hafiz Hafizur Rahman, has accused Imran Khan of disturbing the peace in the region.
हम समझते हैं इमरान खान साहब की हुकूमत ने जहां कश्मीर का सौदा करके उसके बाद गिलगित बल्तिस्तान का अमन बिगाड़ने के लिए इंटरनेशनल लेवल पर मैं समझता हूं ये उन्होंने ठेका लिया है और गिलगित बल्तिस्तान का एक पुरमन माहौल साफ सुथरा माहौल इलेक्शन का यह सबूताज करने के लिए आए खुद ही ये इलेक्शन को मुतनाज़ बनाने के लिए आए हैं और हर वो काम कर रहे हैं जो दुनिया में किसी मुहज़्ज़ब रियासत में यह मुमकिन नहीं होता.
In the run-up to the polls, the Imran Khan government had recently announced granting provisional province status to the region. Locals and political activists in Gilgit-Baltistan have continued to express resentment against the arbitrary decision to alter the legal status and against holding elections in violation of UN resolutions. Rahman says it is one of the several measures adopted by the government to rig the election. Former CM also said that Islamabad had issued strict orders asking officers to toe their line.
Aaj Gilgit mein tashreef laye hain, kal chief minister office mein sare afsaron ko bulaya gaya hai aur khuda ke bando kya kar rahe ho, kis taraf leke ja rahe ho is qoum ko. बड़ी मुश्किल से हमने इस इलाके में बड़ी मेहनत से अमन कायम किया है, बड़ी मेहनत से खुशहाली की तरफ हमने सफर शुरू किया है. आपने प्री पोलिंग के लिए यहाँ पे जो है आपने मर्जी की काबीना बना दी, वो काबीना के सारे वजीर आपके निगरान जो हलकों में फिर रहे हैं कंपेन के लिए. आपने इलेक्शन पासपोर्ट किया, आपने जो है वो जबरदस्ती पार्टियों से वफादारियां तब्दील करा के पीटीआई में लोगों को शामिल कराया, फिर भी आप नहीं जीत सकते. तो अब आप गिलगित बल्तिस्तान के अमन से खेलने के लिए आए हैं, गिलगित बल्तिस्तान को तबाह करना चाहते हैं, आप इस इलेक्शन को मुतनाज़ तरीन इलेक्शन बनाना चाहते हैं ताकि लोग सड़कों पे आ जाएं.
इस्लामाबाद हैज ग्रोन डेस्परेट. इट वांट्स टू गेन कंप्लीट पॉलिटिकल कंट्रोल ओवर द रीजन ऑफ गिलगित बल्तिस्तान. चाइना वांट्स गिलगित बल्तिस्तान टू हैव अ पॉलिटिकल स्टेटस within the constitutional framework of Pakistan so that its ambitious China-Pakistan economic corridor doesn't suffer any political roadblocks. Status elevation would also mean that Pakistan-China nexus can go to any levels of exploitation without undergoing right scrutiny. People say they will never accept being part of Pakistan as their true identity is Indian.
Moving on. Bangladeshi transgenders have received empowering news as the country now has a religious school for the community. This is the first such school where the sexual minority group in the country will be raised into employable mass. Experts and rights group have hailed the development, saying that this marks the beginning of an era where those who have been subjected to discrimination and neglect owing to a deficit of education and sophistication will be treated at par with the rest of the citizens.
Music. With a plan to start many more around the country, Bangladesh has come up with its first religious schools for transgenders. The sexual minority group in the country is largely illiterate owing to several reasons, with one being the absence of exclusive schools for them. Known as hijras in many South Asian countries, people belonging to the transgender community are often banished from their homes at a young age. Deprived of any formal education, many of them survive by begging, selling sex, or dancing at weddings. But now, with schools, they are optimistic of receiving formal education, which will enhance their career prospects in later stages.
মহান আল্লাহ পাকের অশেষ রহমতে আমরা আজকে কোরআন শরীফের শিক্ষা নিয়েছি, এই কারণেই আমরা এখানে এসেছি আজকে এই কোরআনের শিক্ষাটাকে নেয়ার জন্য। আমাদের জন্য বিভিন্ন জায়গায় বিভিন্ন রকম ভাবে অবহেলিত আমরা, কিন্তু এখানে এসে আমাদের জন্য একটা মাদ্রাসা করে দেওয়া হয়েছে। আল্লাহর কাছে লাখ লাখ শুকরিয়া আদায় করছি যে আমাদের জন্য একটা মাদ্রাসা করে দিয়েছে।
The government estimates there are about 10,000 hijras in Bangladesh, but rights groups say the figure could be as high as 1.5 million in the country, of more than 160 million people. In multiple interviews conducted by the Human Rights Watch in 2017, the participating transgender spoke of bullying at school, barriers to employment, difficulty accessing health care, as well as harassment and verbal abuse in both public and private spaces. Interviewees also highlighted the difficulties that arise because a gender identity does not match the gender listed on diplomas, passports, or other legal documents, including their ability to get jobs and to travel. The director of the madrasa says that it was due to rising neglect of the community that they opened the madrasa.
মূলত মানবিক দৃষ্টিকোণ থেকেই এই হিজরাদের জন্য, তৃতীয় লিঙ্গীদের জন্য এই মাদ্রাসাটা করা হয়েছে। কারণ এরা সমাজে চরমভাবে অবহেলিত, কোনো স্কুল, কলেজ, ইউনিভার্সিটি, মাদ্রাসা, কোনো শিক্ষা প্রতিষ্ঠানে যেতে পারে না। তো সেই দৃষ্টিকোণ থেকেই দেখি যে এরা বাহিরে এলোমেলো চলাফেরা করে, এদের উশৃঙ্খল জীবনযাপনের জন্য দায়ী আমরা, কারণ আমরা এদেরকে শিক্ষা দিতে পারি নাই। তো সেই মানবিক দৃষ্টিকোণ থেকে এই প্রতিষ্ঠানটা করা হয়েছে। ইনশাআল্লাহ ধারাবাহিকভাবে আমরা ঢাকা সিটির বিভিন্ন জায়গায় আমরা এই কেন্দ্র চালু করেছি এবং আমরা আশা করছি যে অল্প সময়ের মধ্যে সারা দেশব্যাপী আমাদের এই কার্যক্রম ইনশাআল্লাহ চালু করব।
The rights group say that despite a landmark government's decision in 2013 to recognize hijras as a third gender, they remain marginalized in the country. However, they say that recognizing their worth and rights is a step in the right direction. The community is increasingly being shown faith across the globe, with their fundamental rights being restored. Meanwhile, the neighboring country India is coming up with a transgender university to address the issue of gender discrimination with this minority.
Experts say other South Asian countries, including Pakistan, Nepal and Sri Lanka, should also make efforts to elevate the status of transgender. With that, we come to the end of this week's episode. See you next week. Goodbye and take care.